everyone to Ash Wednesday service. You know, during COVID, we had an Ash Wednesday service through Zoom in 2019 when we got into lockdown. English congregation, we had an Ash Wednesday service. But now we have it in person, and we welcome you, and God has a plan for you today. So let us begin our worship by reciting call to worship. Would you all stand up in your place? The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. We gather to confess our sins and bring a sacrifice of a broken and contrite heart to God, who forgives us and frees us for joyful obedience. Today, we join one another and Christ on the road to the cross and commit ourselves to the Lenten journey ahead of us. May we be faithful to keeping a Lenten fast of justice, charity, and flourishing before God, ourselves, and neighbor. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. As an opening praise, let us sing, Create in Me a Clean Heart. This time, we are going to have a prayer of confession. So if you are joining us online later on or here, let us really have a prayer of confession. Creator God, you fashioned us out of death, breathing your spirit into us so we might sing your praise. And I would like to invite our members, brothers and sisters, to come and recite the next line.
But we have denounced your gifts of life in order to be our own gods, clinging to death-dealing idols of our own making.
We have denied our creaturely status, seeking to lord over others that we label less than.
We squelch all who are different through ignoring, belittling, murdering, and bombing.
We believe survival of the fittest lies, discount the weak, and profit by others' pains. Not trusting your providence, we stop our ears in the cries of those in need because we're afraid we won't have enough.
We have been unfaithful stewards, O Lord. We live in a state of sin among the people of sin. Save for your grace, we perish. Remember our making creator. Remember we are dust. Have mercy on us according to your loving kindness. Breathe new life into us once more, so we might be the people you created us to be. Restore unto us the joy of your salvation, that we might do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Now we're going to praise, centering him at the cross and near Jesus, keep me near the cross. So if you are following us online, I invite you to sing together or meditate upon the lyrics together.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my rapture soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me. There the bright and morning stars sheds its beam around.
At the cross, O Lord, you search me.
O Lord, you search me. You know my way. Even when I fail you, I know you love me. Your holy presence surrounding me.
Let's sing, Jesus, keep me near the cross. One more time.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There's a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flow from Calvary's mountain.
This time I want to invite you to pray with me. We're going to pray and give a thanksgiving over the ashes. And the ashes are a symbol of penitence and repentance. And may be known that today is the first day of your 40 days of journey, of being like Christ, so that God may bless you for the next 40 days with a very special blessing. And in order to start that blessing, we use the ashes to symbolize that we belong to Christ. So I want to invite you to read the Thanksgiving over the ashes prayer with me as we pray together. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Grant that these ashes may be to us a sign of our mortality and penitence, so that we may remember that only by your gracious gifts are we given the everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Now we will proceed with the imposition of ashes. So while Karen Gonzalez, would you come forth first? Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. And I want to invite you to come forth and receive imposition of ashes. Remember that you are dust and you will return to dust. are watching from online, you can do this by lighting a candle, and after you blow a candle on the wick, there should be some dust, some ashes, and you can do that on your forehead like this, on your own. If you can do that, do this in remembrance of remembering who you are, that we come from dust, and we will return to dust, but we have eternal life in Christ. Let us pray. May the Almighty God and merciful God, who desires not the death of a sinner, but that we turn from wickedness and live, accept your repentance, forgive your sins, and restore you by the Holy Spirit to renew newness of life. In Jesus' name, amen. Today's scripture comes from Joel, book of Joel, verse 12 through 13. And I will read the first verse, and I want to invite you all to read the second verse together. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So I'm not going to be too long today, but we are starting 40 days of Holy Season. And if you look at the back of your bulletin, it explains what Lent is about. Lent is 40 days that symbolizes 40 years of Israelites in the wilderness and 40 days of Jesus in the wilderness. And as you remember, those 40 days, as we spend the 40 days, it does not include Sunday, because each Sunday represents mini Easter. So that even if you are fasting, you should not fast on Sunday, because that's a day of celebration. So excluding those Sundays, the 40 days continue to what we call the Holy Saturday. And during those 40 days, we do three things. We pray, and some of us fast and give. Now, fasting can be different forms. It doesn't have to be food. You could fast from using social media, or you could fast from your habits that you want, you think it's keeping you unhealthy. Or some people fast coffee, or some people don't fast from watching TV or their favorite sports for just that period, so that they can spend more time thinking about their lives in God, in Christ. So when you do that, eventually we begin to pray more, because we have a prayerful heart, and then we give to others. But most importantly, we need to focus during the 40 days as Jesus did. What did Jesus do in the wilderness? He was preparing for his ministry. At the same time, who was in the wilderness? The devil was in the wilderness. So I want to explain that in our lives, even today, the devil does try to harm us and tempt us throughout today. And sometimes if we are too much equipped, drenched in sin, we tend to not be able to distinguish the whisper of the devil. But the devil continues to whisper us. And when you get scared, when you get anxious, when you get nervous, it's devil. Because God does not make you fear or anxious on purpose. So when negative thoughts come into your mind, for example, oh, I'm not going to make it, or oh, I'm such a terrible in this, or I don't know if I can do this, or some negative thoughts come, when glass half empty mentality comes to you, or when you think that instead of the opportunity, you see the problem all the time, and you don't want to do anything and passively just remain. But some people, even in the crisis, they see an opportunity, and what God is giving them, they see something great. For example, today is such a special day in the evening because we have first historic Ash Wednesday service, and you are invited to the table that God has prepared for you, and it's such a great evening. But in some of our minds, we might be thinking about, oh, I'm so worried about school. I'm so worried about future family, or I'm so worried about different kinds of problems. That is not what God is giving you, because God clearly said, do not worry about anything. Tomorrow will care for itself. Look at the birds in the sky and the lilies in the field. First seek the kingdom of God, and everything will fall into this place. How many times did Jesus have to say this? Excuse me. However, the devil's job is to try to make you give up or think in a negative way or a dark way. The devil's job is for people to dislike their pastor or the pastors to feel discouraged because, you know, get rid of the army, what do they have to do? Kill the general. Even though that general is like not that capable, if they don't have any general, it's sure bet they're going to lose. So, and then the devil asks us to have negative thoughts about something, somebody in the church or somebody in the neighborhood, and then begin to talk about that person as if it's harmless, but gets to spread the news. Excuse me, devil has a lot of strategies. And, you know, I fight with the devil since this morning too. However, that's when I feel I need to pray. And I praise God. And I was praising God with the song that I was preparing today. At the cross, I bent my knees. I just cried. Today, there was nobody at church in the afternoon. In the office, I was just singing, practicing for us. And when I was singing, I just could not sing. I know you love me, and I could not sing. So I was so worried if I'm going to cry today. And that's also the devil's work. I don't need to worry because I didn't cry, as you have seen. But then there is a way that God encourages me. For example, when I was coming here at around 6:35, I saw Margie and Ed walking by, and I was so happy. I was so happy because we were having Ash Wednesday service, and it made me to see them again. Because during the retreat, I was thinking about them off and on, if they could be here, how would it be? And that's amazing. So, you know, these are not unrelated. We use the language of the darkness and light. And our life is always a mixture of shadow and light. But God wants us to push forth as a light and not be consumed in darkness. And when we have anxieties, fears, or worries, that is unbiblical. When we have judgments about other people or prejudice about other things, we should not have that. We should have a curiosity, but not conclusive judgment. If somebody, some culture have a very different way of doing things, we should be curious and want to get to know and appreciate the goodness of why they're doing that in that environment instead of saying, oh, they're not good. So there are always different ways of looking at things. You know, when I was teaching, I was on TV in a couple of broadcasting stations, educational broadcasting station, and JEI, it's called Channing, and then they pay me, and then I teach in TV. But because my dad was a revivalist pastor, and our pastors usually just scream a lot, and so they, you guys look funny today, with scream a lot. So I used to teach like 12 hours a day, so my I would have a bad throat there. I would be like, I sound like a husky voice. So I was like going there and then filming something for the TV station, and one of the people said, oh, his voice is too unpleasant to listen to. Which is, you know, your voice should be like smooth, but my voice is always gone. So I sounded like somebody in a market street, like trying to sell cheap stuff. $5, $5, three for $5, something like that. But then their boss, the boss's boss, they were complaining about, is this guy famous teacher at all? Because his voice is like all gone. I think people are going to turn off the TV. And then the senior boss said, you know, I like his voice because of his voice is so not soft, people are not going to fall asleep. So he was looking at it a good way. But eventually, like, people knew what I was trying to do, and the truth just revealed itself. So it depends on how people view you. You don't want to have a negative darkness or stereotypes or hopelessness in your life. And that is one thing that you have to overcome during Lent, during 40 years. When the devil came and told Jesus to do this and this and that, we should be able to discern what comes from darkness or devil or satanic evil thoughts. And it sometimes needs training, but easy way to confirm is to go through the scriptures and pray and praise and see if it sits well or if it makes you feel you're a little bit more away from God, and that is wrong. So that is one of the things that we should do. But most importantly, if we look at Psalm 50, 51, it says, create in me a clean heart, which means it's God who creates within us a clean heart, and you cannot clean your heart. We are not capable of cleaning our heart. God cleans our heart when we remember and drink spiritually the blood of Jesus Christ. Then it cleanses our hearts. It's a miraculous thing. It is not our work, but God's grace that cleanses us. And then the second thing, God desires our heart to have commitment and to worship, to be holy, and to do good in the world. Not to show to others, but to genuinely be humble and broken and contrite in heart. So second thing we want to do, not only clean your heart from negative thoughts, second thing you want to do, try to be humble. Try to be really humble. Even if you feel like you're not humble, just be humble or try to be humble. It doesn't mean like self-defecation, but it just means that always being genuine and not trying to be proud. And it's like fasting. Blessed are those who fast, and blessed are those who mourn. Those are the people who God loves. So I don't need to be humble in a way like a lot of other people are, because I'm like rookie pastor. And I'm not even a rookie pastor. I was the youngest person when I was 26 as a pastor, but now I'm like the oldest starting pastor, second career pastor now. So I'm like the lowest bottom of the totem pole, both in our church and in the denomination. So I don't have any reason to be proud. However, it is my goal and prayer to God that when I become older than even now, that I become even humbler. Humbler. You know why? Because instead of the crown of ashes, the real crown of life is when you become really humble. So those 40 days, it's a good time to focus our life in humility. So repentance, when it's repeated, it becomes humility. It becomes humility. You know how we try to put a makeup and put an Instagram? It's because we want to look pretty to others. nobody puts ashes on their face and take a picture. But that is why we put ashes in our faces, to remind us that the true beauty comes from the heart. And third thing we should remember is that today's scripture says, God is slow to anger. He's infinitely gracious and compassionate, which is the reason we can repent and humble ourselves, because he saves us by the blood of the cross. Therefore, we need to not worry about anything, because all we need to worry is to overcome the temptation of those devil's whispers in our lives that makes us insecure, and that makes us be cowards and talk negatively or behind people's back. We need to be aware of that and fight that with the word and prayer. And then you'll see, after 40 days, you will see your life have changed. It takes about 40 days to see the effects. You know how you eat a medicine? It takes about 5 days to see. If you take Paxlovid for COVID, you have to take it for 5 days to see the effect. Likewise, it takes about 40 days. That's why we have 40 days of fasting and prayer. And you will see some signs that you can feel. And then off you go with the rest of your life, living a humble life. You know, some of us have a hard time because we feel so attached to things. You know, I visited this house in our Newtown area. He's an old member of our church, long time ago, 30 years ago. And one of the Kwansanims asked me to come and visit them. So I went there to invite them back to church. And this old gentleman wasn't in church for so long, he forgot that pastors don't drink. So this gentleman, when I went inside with this Kwansanim, he said, "Oh, have a seat." And he was so kind. "Do you want a beer?" he said. "Would you like a beer or Coke?" Ah, this is a temptation. And then last week, I went out on a golf course with a friend. And this person is new to church, so he doesn't know a lot. So we went to golf. And then he said, "Pastor, do you want a beer?" And then it dawned on me, you can drink beer on a golf course? And then say, "No, sorry, I'll get fired if I drink a beer on a golf course with a church member." And then I think he drank beer while I was not looking, because by the end of the 18th course, he was kind of drunk. But that was weird, because I've never seen him drink something, but he somehow drank when I was doing something else. Yeah, I don't know how to do it. But then I realized, why would people want to drink on a golf course? It's a drunken driving, like drunken golfer. But you know, and then I went to this person's house, and he had so many things. His house was big, but was packed with all kinds of things from all over Ireland. And there was not enough place to sit down. And all kinds of things, which I call, I'm sorry, junks. Especially if you grow up really poor when you're young, like in Korean War, like my grandma and mama, and they're hungry. They hold on to things. They don't want to throw them away. They like to accumulate them all until the space runs out. Especially, I found that moms like new dishes. And women that I know like new bags. They love the bags so much, they don't have anything to put in there, but they like the bags. And when it rains, they put umbrella on their bag. Now I feel like I'm sitting. However, you know, that's part of our story. When we grow up, those stories tell us, because we have unfilled needs and sorrows and sadness and loneliness that we felt when we were growing up. We're trying to fill that needs with things. And during Lent, God is telling us to break away from attachment to those things. That's why you need to give. Be bold and give what you really cherish, because you should not cherish things. Test yourself, and you will. will forever possess the crown of life. So it doesn't mean that, oh, they're poor people, homeless people, go help them, it's a good thing. It's not that. It's detach yourself from all things. But we, originally, from dust, that's so sad, right? But that's so amazing because God can create us out of dust. How much more he can create our bodies into spiritual bodies. So when we say, the scriptures say, we come from dust, we will return to dust, that is talking about the material nature, which is so true. So we should not dwell on the dust. And the only thing that continues right now is our heart, the clean heart, the forgiven heart, the heart that is humble and broken before God, which forms a new spiritual body at the time of the resurrection according to 1 Corinthians 15. It becomes a non-aging, non-corruptible, eternal body that is exactly in the perfect state of physical bodies. We believe in the resurrection of the body, brothers and sisters. Theologically, that means we will have exactly the kind of body that we think that we have, but it will be 2.0, 3.0 version of our body because it will not get older and it will last forever. So I want to invite you to make the next 40 days a special time. First, to pray for the clean heart, to fight off any of the devil's whispers. Sometimes it's easy to do this, you know. If you have a really praying Christian, ask them, you know, I have this kind of thought. Is this correct? Is this biblical? Is this, or am I just worrying too much? And they will tell you. I do that with my mother. And you can do that with mentors or pastors. Or I have many people who you trust. And second, humble yourself. And third, throw away, give away most of what you don't really need. Try that. Don't hold on to them. They're killing you. They're suffocating you. Because they will not follow you to eternal life. Especially if you have large inheritance. It will just make your children fight over it. And human beings are such that they lose what's really important because of what's not important. What's really important is the brotherly love, sisterly love among siblings and a family. Instead of trying to hire a lawyer and divide the inheritance, they are dust, brothers and sisters. And third, pray to God so that he will create in you the heart of hope and message of trust so that you can overcome depression, sad thoughts, or devil temptations and whispers that you can overcome through those 40 days. So when you think about 40 days, it's not about not eating red meat. Or it's not doing something that you really like to do. But it's a time when you become detached and independent so that you can feel the freedom. So that once you are freed, you can become a true soldier for God. And those 40 days, may the Spirit of God be with you. And as a sign, we have ashes on our head. I pray that in your heart, you cover them with ashes. You know, one of the things that ashes do is they have a cleansing property. Did you know that? So you put in the water and then cleanse them. So may we be cleansed throughout the next 40 days of journey that we walk together each Sunday and every day. Let us gather our offerings if you have some, if you have brought any offerings, or if you have can do online or later as we sing Jesus Remember Me. us all stand and pray to the Lord. Holy God, as we start the journey of Lent, give us a will of repentance, a mind of sacrificial love, and a heart of gratitude, and the hope for true eternal happiness and life in you. Indeed, you are gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. We offer our gifts and our whole selves during this season of Lent, asking that you might strengthen us, making us clean in our hearts for the journey. In the name of Christ, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. May we go to confess God's love to broken and hurting world. As we wear the ashes of penitence on our bodies, so we carry the reconciling love of God we have received to a world desperately in need of justice, abundance, and flourishing. May grace of Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the protection of the Holy Spirit go with you in Jesus' name. Amen.